everyone. I'm Eliza York. I'm doing my PhD in neuroscience with Dr. Ryan McVicker in the Center for Brain Health at UBC. And so what that actually means is I spend most of my day hidden away in a dark microscope room, staring at a computer screen, and doing a little bit of imaging and exploring of the brain's immune system. So I want to talk to you about what the brain's immune system actually is. So I'm sure you're all familiar with the immune system. These are the macrophage, T cells, B cells. They're always patrolling the environment of your body, making sure you're not sick. It's cold and flu season. If you get a virus, you get a bacteria, they're the first ones that are going to get there and respond and keep you protected from any kind of infection. However, the brain's actually an immune-privileged organ. And this was found out recently, and it's what this means is that the brain and spinal cord actually aren't part of that peripheral immune system, so they don't have those cells to protect them. And this is because of a structure called the blood-brain barrier. However, it would be extremely dangerous for this tissue not to be protected at all. So what they have is a special type of cell called microglia, which are the resident macrophage of the brain, or the immune cells of the nervous system. And so if you can see the top image here is the red cell is a neuron. So they have this cell body, which is the round part, and then they have axons and dendrites, which are kind of like arms reaching out. So information comes in through the dendrites and is sent out through the axons. So that's a very common type of cell in the central nervous system most people have heard of. But there's also another class of cell called the glia cells. And these were originally, when they were discovered, thought to just be structural support of the brain, that they were just there like glue. But we've actually found out that they're extremely important in maintaining proper functioning of the nervous system. And one subtype of the glia cells are the microglia. So in the bottom image, imagine if you took that a little piece of that neuron and zoomed in on it by manifold, then you would see these tiny little cells, these green microglia, and they're actually about 2.5 here in this image, and they're tiling completely around this cell. So they're completely throughout the brain everywhere, constantly surveying their environment. So the larger green blob is the cell body, and similar to the neurons, they have these processes that reach out, and they're constantly moving inside the brain tissue. So even right now, in a healthy human brain, there are microglia moving around, and with their end processes, they're contacting neurons, making sure that neuron is firing properly. They're making sure that the environment is appropriate for the neurons to function in, so there aren't any damaging ions there. They're also checking to make sure that there's no damage or pathogens. If there are, these are the cells that are the first responders, and they're going to react instantly and try and protect the brain from any kind of spreading damage. So here I'm going to show you a video of time-lapse imaging that we do in the lab. The green cells, again, are the microglia. You can see the larger blobs are their cell bodies, and they have this kind of cloud of processes around them. And those processes, you'll see them moving around quite rapidly. This is around a 30-minute video compressed to about 30 seconds. And then what I'm going to do is make a laser lesion in the tissue. So we actually burn a hole in the tissue, which is representative of a neuron dying or some sort of inflammatory damage. And you'll see the microglia respond very rapidly. So the beginning part when the microglia are moving around, that's hopefully what's happening in everyone's brain right now, obviously a little bit slower, but hopefully they're checking to make sure everything's functioning properly. And if anything does happen, like say there's a leak in a blood vessel, the microglia will send the processes out, contact it, and stop any spread of further damage. So hopefully in the video you saw that these cells are very dynamic and they can change their shapes. And we can actually use the shape of these cells to tell us a little bit about what's happening in that environment, what those cells are up to in the tissue. And so here there's a circle of different shapes that these microglia can take on. So the top is a healthy one, lots of processes. On the bottom is something called amoeboid or activated microglia. And this is what the microglia will become if you have some sort of bacterial infection, because they're going to want to move around the tissue and eat any kind of bacteria or pathogen. These are also found in the site of stroke damage or in chronic diseases like Alzheimer's disease. You'll find these amoeboid microglia around the plaques. So we can really tell that something's wrong with the tissue if they're amoeboid. But it's not a dichotomy. You can see that there are many different types of cells that the microglia can assume. And so we can use that as an indicator of the tissue and the health of the tissue. So this is an example of an experiment that we did in the lab. On the left is control, because it's important to have control always. And you can see that they have normal cell bodies. Again, those are the larger blobs and the clouds of processes around them. In the middle, we've added a compound that blocks neural function. So this tissue is not firing any kind of signals. And this would be very concerning to the microglia, because that's not healthy. It might be like a site of stroke, where they're not getting glucose, they're not getting oxygen. And you see the microglia have retracted their processes, and they've become amoeboid. So they know something's wrong, and they're just waiting for a next signal to tell them what to do. In the reverse, on the left side, we've added a compound that mimics neural activity. So this might be like a seizure where the neurons are hyperactive and there's too much firing. And here, unlike when we block neural activity, the microglia send their processes out and they have tons of these little endpoints. And what we think they're doing is contacting the neurons and trying to keep them quiet, trying to keep them from firing too much. It can be damaging to the tissue. So looking at the shape of the cells and observing how they look, we can tell a lot about the function. And this isn't true just in microglia, it's true in many cells. And here I want to introduce a very famous neuroscientist called Ramon y Cajal, and he's also considered the father of neuroscience, so he's a pretty important guy. And he was actually first trained as an artist, and he wanted to be an artist when he was young. And first was introduced to medicine because his father was a physician and hired him for the summer to take medical drawings, so just to draw what he saw in the lab. And he found this fascinating, and he went on to become a physician himself and to start his own neuroscience research lab. And what he would do is take pieces of tissue, mainly brain and spinal cord tissue, stain it, and then spend all morning at the microscope just staring at this tissue, looking around, observing what the cells look like. And then in the afternoon, he would draw them. And he wouldn't just make a copy of the cell, but he would make a representation. So he would think of rules that all these cells could fit into, and he would use his drawing to think about these rules and to make a representative diagram of what these cells would look like. And he made, in his lifetime, hundreds and hundreds of drawings, and many of them are actually on tour through North America right now. So I just wanted to plug this exhibit, The Beautiful Brain, which is at the Morris and Helen Belkin Art Gallery until December 3rd. So if you have the chance to get out there, I really recommend checking it out, because they're amazing drawings. There are many of them. So in addition to using art to think about what was happening in the tissue to draw these neurons, he was using that to make theories of what was happening and then to represent them. So here I have a few more examples of the drawings. So an example of one of the theories that I came up with is the neuron doctrine, and it's the idea that each neuron is its own cell. Before this, people thought there was just an interconnected web of tissue, but now we know that Cajal was correct, and we couldn't actually confirm he was correct until after he had passed away. So it was amazing that he could discover this just by looking at the tissue. So the image on the top left is one of my favorite. It shows neurons, and they're in the light gray color. And he's used a darker color to draw your attention to the astrocytes, which are lying around the neurons, kind of like that microglia picture I showed you earlier. So Cajal, even in the late 1800s, recognized the importance of glia cells. They're also reaching out and contacting a blood vessel, which is that kind of arcing structure coming down. So he recognized that glia cells were actually helping to form the blood-brain barrier. On your right, there's an example of a single neuron. This is probably one of his most famous drawings, a pyramidal neuron. And he recognized that there was a direction of flow in the brain. So it wasn't just information going everywhere, but the neurons would take it in from one side, process it, and send it on. And he also looked at connectivity. So on the left is a hippocampus, which is important for learning and memory. And on the right is a spinal cord. And here he's drawn several cells, and he's shown the connection between neurons. So he was really able to use art to think about what was happening in the tissue, come up with these amazing theories which are still true today, and then present that very clearly in his drawings. And so I wanted to take that idea of art as a way of thinking about science and seeing things in a way of presenting it and bring that back to modern research. So to do that, I was just going to give an example of another project that I'm working on in the lab. And here we're doing a collaboration with Dr. Brett Finlay and his student Belinda Bauer, and they're in the microbiome department. And so they're interested in the gut microbiology and what happens in malnourished individuals. So low protein, low fat is malnourished treatment. What happens to the immune system in the brain? And so here we have on the left, again, a control, and then on the right, the malnourished. And so we spend hours and hours in the microscope room taking these images and looking at them, and you become very familiar with these cells and you start to notice subtle differences. And so I don't consider myself an artist, but by taking these images, I feel like you're immersing yourself and observing the tissue, and you start to think of what might be happening to cause changes. So we've noticed that the cells on the right, the malnourished, have longer processes. They're covering more of the brain tissue. So clearly something is different. And by looking at them, we're trying to decide what it is that they're actually doing in this malnourished brain, and then perform experiments to test that. So in addition to thinking about science, we also need art to represent it. So here again is the same image, so the control and malnourished treatments. And here in the blue, you can see these are the microglia, and there's so much more blue covered in the malnourished treatment, less of the black tissue. So the black is represented of empty brain space. So the microglia in the malnourished brain are covering more of that volume, and on the right, you can see a representative cell, and each of those cells is larger in the malnourished condition. So when you're making a paper that you're going to publish, a scientific article, each figure has to support one of your scientific arguments. In addition to imaging, we can also make, obviously this is a cartoon, so obviously a graphical representation of an abstract. And it's important to be artistic here because you need to show an entire idea represented clearly in a single image. And I think the clearest example of that is actually here's just a few examples of scientific journals, and these images are from scientists who are performing work and then trying to represent an entire idea in a single image. So these need to be not only aesthetically pleasing, I think they're extremely artistic, personally, but they also have to be very informative. And so I just wanted to leave you with a quote by Cicero, that art is born of the observation and investigation of nature, and I would argue that science itself is the observation and investigation of nature. So I think these are not two separate things. The art and the science aren't two separate studies, but rather a way of observing the world around us. So thank you. I'd take any questions.